Hi friends, like we discussed, we will be discussing facial nerve palsy today, the live streaming of facial nerve palsy, a very important topic of ENT. I'm Dr. Sanjay Agarwal, and when we talk about facial nerve palsy, anatomy of facial nerve becomes very, very important. Without this, you cannot understand, and you all know that anatomy of facial nerve also carries a lot of questions in the all forms of exam, whether it is NEET or AIMS or whatever. Now, I'll tell you a very brief anatomy of facial nerve, and then we'll talk about the facial nerve palsy. Facial nerve, as we all know, is a mixed nerve, isn't it? It's a seventh cranial nerve, a mixed nerve, but it is mainly a sensory nerve. Mainly a motor nerve. So motor is a predominant part, sensory is also attached to it. Now, where does the motor come from? The motor, so if I draw the skull base, let's say this is the anterior cranial fossa, middle cranial fossa, and inferior cranial fossa. And behind, this is when you're seeing from the front, there's a nose here. And there's an orbit here. The middle ear is somewhere here. Let's say this is the middle ear, this is the posterior wall of the middle ear, and there is an anterior wall of the middle ear. And in the cranial cavity, we have the brain stem. Let's say this is the pons area. And the nucleus of the facial nerve lies in this pons, somewhere here. And the motor fiber, I'm writing here motor, will come from this. Now, in the brain stem, or in the pons to be more precise, there are four nucleus. There are nucleus of 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th. So there is a 6th nerve nucleus also. Now, when the motor fiber of the facial comes from the nucleus, the fiber winds around the nucleus of the 6th nerve, and they come out to the CP angle, and they will come to the middle ear. Now, how do they enter the temporal bone? Middle ear lies in the temporal bone, we all know. So how are the fibers of this facial nerve going to enter into the temporal bone and from there into the middle ear? Now, in the posterior part of the temporal bone, there is a canal called internal acoustic meatus. Like we were outside, there is a meatus called external auditory meatus. Similarly, there is a meatus on the other side of the temporal bone, the inner side, and that's called internal auditory meatus or inner meatus, which I draw like this. Let's say it is something like this, or if I draw it here, I draw it like this. This is internal auditory meatus, right? Now, how much is the length of the internal auditory meatus? This is another MCQ. The length of the internal auditory meatus is 8 to 10 millimeters, or roughly 1 centimeter. And as I've drawn here, it is nearly a conical shape meatus. Like we have external meatus, what is the shape of the external meatus? We all know it is S-shaped, and the length is 24 millimeters, right? Similarly, internal auditory meatus is more or less a cone shape, and it is 8 to 10 millimeters. This is an MCQ. Now, so this nerve will have to enter through the internal auditory meatus along with the three branches of the 8th nerve. 8th nerve, we all know, vestibulocochlear has three branches: cochlear, superior vestibular, inferior vestibular, plus facial. So internal acoustic meatus will have four nerves. That's why this meatus is divided into four compartments by two bony bars. There is a vertical bar like this in the internal acoustic meatus, and there is a horizontal bar like this in the meatus. So when you have a vertical bar and the horizontal bar, this meatus gets divided into four compartments: anterosuperior, posterosuperior, anteroinferior, posteroinferior. Now, these two bars have names. This inferior bar, or the vertical bar, is called the Bill's bar. This is a very, very important name. I'm sure most of you know this name already. Bill's bar. So Bill's bar is a vertical bar in the internal acoustic meatus. The horizontal one also has a name, but it's not a very important name. But still, if you can remember, it's called the falciform crest. Falciform crest. So vertical bar is the Bill's bar, the horizontal bar is the falciform crest, and this these two bars, they divide the internal costic meatus into four quadrants: anterosuperior, posterosuperior, anteroinferior, posteroinferior. Each will carry a nerve, either facial nerve, cochlear branch of the eighth nerve, superior vestibular branch of the eighth nerve, or inferior vestibular branch of the eighth nerve. We are talking about facial nerve. So facial nerve rise in which compartment in the internal costic meatus? It runs through anterosuperior compartment, right? So this is another very important MCQ, that which part of the internal costic meatus contains the facial nerve? The anterosuperior compartment. What is behind that? That is what lies in the posterosuperior compartment of the internal costic meatus? And the answer is superior vestibular nerve. This is superior compartment. If the facial nerve lies in the anterosuperior compartment, only one more superior compartment is left, and that is posterosuperior compartment. So superior compartment will have superior nerve, superior vestibular nerve. And below the superior vestibular nerve, that is posteroinferior compartment, contains the inferior vestibular. Superior, below that has to be inferior nerve. So what lies in the anteroinferior compartment? Cochlear nerve. So let's say if this is the anterosuperior compartment which contains the facial nerve, let's say, then behind this will be the superior vestibular nerve, and below the facial nerve will be the cochlear nerve. C stands for cochlear nerve, and behind the cochlear nerve will be the inferior vestibular nerve, right? Why is this important? A, they ask you facial nerve lies in which compartment of the internal costic meatus, so you know it is anterosuperior compartment. B, sometimes they ask you this Bill's bar separates the facial nerve from which of the following nerves. So we know very clearly now that the Bill's bar separates the facial nerve from the superior vestibular nerve. Or if they ask you the falciform crest separates the facial nerve from which nerve, then it's the cochlear nerve. Facial nerve, below lies the cochlear nerve. Behind the facial nerve is the superior vestibular nerve. And the third important question they may ask you is, how much of the facial nerve runs through the internal acoustic meatus? Because the length of the internal acoustic meatus is 8 to 10 millimeters, so the part of the facial nerve that runs through the internal acoustic meatus has to be 8 to 10 millimeters. So this much of the facial nerve, 8 to 10 millimeters, runs through the internal acoustic meatus. So these are the important points about internal acoustic meatus related to the facial nerve. So I'll remove this area, all this, because we need all this space. Now, once the facial nerve crosses the internal acoustic meatus, it enters a labyrinth. So that becomes a labyrinthine part of the facial nerve. We discuss the meatal part of the facial nerve because it runs in the internal acoustic meatus. And now we have the labyrinthine part of the facial nerve. Now, this part in the labyrinth is a very, very important part. So, like in the meatus, I asked you how much of the facial nerve runs through the internal acoustic meatus, and the answer was 8 to 10 millimeters. Right? Similarly, if I ask you how much of the facial nerve runs through the labyrinthine part, then it is 3 to 4 millimeters. So, much smaller part as compared to the internal acoustic meatus. In fact, out of the entire part, all the parts of the facial nerve, we compare all of them, this is the smallest part of the facial nerve. Also the narrowest part. So labyrinthine part of the facial nerve is the smallest as well as the narrowest part of the facial nerve. Now this becomes a very significant point. What is the implication? The implication is, because it is the narrowest part, it gets compressed very easily. And therefore, when you have to do a surgery and do a decompression of the facial nerve, this is where it is most commonly done. Whenever you hear this term decompression of the facial nerve, and they ask you which is the most common part that is decompressed in the facial nerve, the narrowest part. And which is the narrowest part? The labyrinthine part. And because of this, labyrinthine part of the facial nerve is called the bottleneck, or more precisely, it is called fish physiological bottleneck of the facial nerve. So this is the labyrinthine part. If I ask you which is the bottleneck of the facial nerve, or physiological bottleneck of the facial nerve, it is a labyrinthine part of the facial nerve. This is another very important MCQ. Now if you take a bottle and look at the bottle, which is the narrowest part of a bottle? At the top there is a cap. If you cross the cap, that becomes the neck of the bottle, and that is the narrowest part. So this becomes the narrowest part. When we use the word bottleneck, we talk about the narrowest part. When you are driving on the road is very wide, and you say the road is very wide, and we are almost flying through the road. Somebody will say, but at the end of the road, there is a bottleneck. So what is bottleneck means? It suddenly becomes narrow, and the vehicles get stuck, there's a jam there. So in the fascia nerve also there is a bottleneck, and that bottleneck lies in the labyrinthine part, which is the narrowest and the smallest part. After that, so if you look at this part of the fascia nerve in the diagram, the fascia nerve is running anteriorly, right? At the end of the labyrinthine part, the fascia nerve turns backwards. It turns back like this, it comes from the middle ear and turns backwards and comes to the posterior wall of the middle ear. It turns like this. So there is a turn here, and the turn of the fascia nerve is called zeno. So there is a zeno in the labyrinth, after which the fascia nerve almost turns 180 degree backwards and comes in the middle ear. Now the fascia nerve has entered the middle ear and it is running backwards horizontally. This part of the fascia nerve is called the horizontal part of the fascia nerve. Horizontal part is also sometimes called the tympanic part. Horizontal part or tympanic part of the fascia nerve is this part in the middle ear after it enters from the labyrinth, from the first genu, and then it goes to the posterior wall. And this is roughly 12 to 14 millimeters, on an average 13 millimeters long. And after that, what happens on the posterior wall? The fascia nerve turns downwards and runs on the posterior wall down and comes out of the ear, and this becomes the vertical part. Vertical part of the fascia nerve, also called the mastoid part. Why do you think it's called the mastoid part? See, this is a posterior wall of the ear. This is the ear, the posterior wall. What is behind the ear? The mastoid. So this posterior wall separates the ear, middle ear and the external ear from the mastoid. So behind this wall is the mastoid. So this part of the fascia nerve can be called the mastoid part of the fascia nerve. In the temporal bone, so these are the four parts of the fascia nerve. These are the four parts of the fascia nerve in the temporal bone. We have the meatal part. We have the labyrinthine part. We have the horizontal, which is called the tympanic part. And we have the vertical, which is also called the mastoid part of the fascia nerve. Now each of the four parts have some anatomical significance from the exam point of view, and this is what I am going to tell you next. Meatal part, I told you already, it is 8 to 10 millimeters long. It lies on the anterosuperior quadrant, separated by the Bell's bar from the superior vestibular nerve and from the falciform crest from the cochlear nerve. Labyrinthine part, I told you, is the narrowest and the smallest part, 3 to 4 millimeters only, and it's called physiological bottleneck, and therefore it gets compressed very easily, and you may have to do decompression when there is a facial palsy in this part. Now horizontal part and vertical part, before I tell you about these two parts, now the moment the fascia nerve comes out of this internal acoustic meatus in the temporal bone and then runs through the labyrinth and the middle ear horizontal part and the posterior wall vertical part, this part of the ear has a canal. There is a canal here, and the facial nerve runs through this canal, and this canal runs just after the internal acoustic meatus. The moment the facial nerve comes out of the internal acoustic meatus, it enters this canal. So the labyrinthine part, the horizontal part and the vertical part, they are all in this canal. So facial nerve is not exposed in the labyrinth, in the temporal bone. It is a protected by a bony canal, and this canal is called, you know what is the name of this canal? This canal is called the fallopian canal. So don't confuse with the fallopian tube. We all know the fallopian tube, but we also have a fallopian canal in the ear, in the temporal bone. And what is this canal? This canal is also called facial canal. Why is this canal called the facial canal? Because the fascia nerve runs through this canal in the ear. In fact, out of any cranial nerve running through the, this is the longest nerve running through any canal. So if they ask you which cranial nerve runs through the canal, has the longest path running through the canal, it is the fascia nerve running, having the longest path through any canal, and this canal is called the fallopian canal. That's why if this is a fascia nerve, let's say this pen is a fascia nerve, so this is a canal, the fascia nerve is running through this canal. And all around the fascia nerve, there is a bony canal. If the canal is very wide, then what happens? If your fascia nerve gets inflamed due to anything, viral infection or anything, if the fascia nerve gets inflamed and swells up, all around the fascia nerve, because the canal is very wide, the fascia nerve has area or space to grow or expand. So it doesn't get compressed. But like I told you, in the labyrinthine part, this canal is very narrow, between the facial nerve and this wall of the canal, there is hardly any space. That's why it's called the bottleneck. And now if this facial nerve in this part gets inflamed, there is no space for the facial nerve to swell or expand. So when the facial nerve, there is an edema around this facial nerve, and this edema cannot go out because there is a bony canal all around. So this edema compresses the fibers of the nerve. So facial nerve gets decompressed. That's why I told you that the most common area where the facial nerve gets decompressed is the labyrinthine part of the facial nerve. And that's why in these patients, sometimes you have to remove this canal, bony canal. So if you remove this canal from this area, the facial nerve now becomes free and it can easily expand and there will be no decompression. That's called decompression of the facial nerve. So you have to remove this bony canal in a decompression of the facial nerve. But in the horizontal part, also there is a canal, the tympanic part running through the middle ear, the horizontally. Now this part of the canal is very often dehiscent. Not the entire canal, some part there is a gap, the canal has, wall has not developed completely. So the facial nerve is exposed. So this is another question, that which part of the facial canal is, or fallopian canal is most commonly dehiscent, absent? That is the horizontal part or the tympanic part of the facial nerve, which is running through the middle ear. So if your canal is dehiscent, the horizontal part, quite obviously the facial nerve is exposed now. And that's why in middle ear disease, like ASOM, CSOM, tubercular otitis media, or even benign tumor like glomus tumor, if I ask you that in middle ear diseases, which part of the facial nerve gets involved most commonly, then it is this horizontal part, because it is most commonly dehiscent. And which part of the horizontal part is most commonly dehiscent? Just above the oval window. Because oval window, I'm sure if I draw here, let's say this is the promontory. There's oval window here and there's a round window. One round window is below, this is round window. This oval window, as I've drawn here, the facial nerve runs just above the oval window. And oval window, we all know, what covers the oval window? Foot plate of the stapes. So facial nerve is running just above the foot plate and the oval window, and this is precisely the part that is dehiscent most commonly. So two importance of this dehiscence. A, I told you, because of the dehiscence, it can get involved in middle ear conditions like ASOM, glue ear, CSOM, tubercular otitis media, glomus tumor, any of these. And second thing, now because the canal is absent, the facial nerve is not straight. Sometimes it is hanging down. The gravity pulls the nerve and it is hanging down and it runs over the foot plate and the stapes. This is another very important point, that if your canal in this part is dehiscent, your facial nerve may hang down of the canal, and because this dehiscent part is just above the foot plate and the oval window, it may run over the foot plate and the stapes. If this happens, this anatomy happens, this is called overhanging facial nerve. So when we use the word overhanging facial nerve, it means the facial nerve is hanging over the foot plate and the stapes, right? So this is another term very important. Now what is the significance of this term or this feature that is overhanging facial nerve? The significance is that when we do stapedectomy surgery in a patient of otosclerosis, passive otosclerosis, sometimes you have to do stapedectomy, right? And we have to manipulate the stapes and the foot plate, we have to make a hole in the foot plate and all that, and facial nerve is running just above that. So facial nerve palsy is very common. Facial nerve trauma can happen, facial nerve palsy can happen. That's why in a stapedectomy and stapedotomy surgery, one of the contraindications is overhanging facial nerve. If there is an overhanging facial nerve, we try not to do stapedectomy or stapedotomy. Should we try to do surgery, the trauma to the facial nerve can happen leading to facial palsy. Even if you are very careful during the surgery of stapedectomy, you know beforehand there is an overhanging facial nerve, for instance, and you are very careful during the surgery, you stay away from the facial nerve, not making diligent steps so that you don't traumatize the facial nerve, still you putting a prosthesis there, and after this, the prosthesis may compress the facial nerve, because it is very close to the prosthesis, that stapes prosthesis, and later on also it can traumatize and cause facial nerve palsy. That's why in stapedectomy surgery, we try and avoid stapedectomy, stapedotomy surgery, because of the same reason. So this is the importance of the horizontal part. And then we come down to the vertical part or the mastoid part in the posterior wall of the facial middle ear. Now why this part is important? Now when we do surgery of the ear, mastoidectomies, especially modified radical mastoidectomy or even radical mastoidectomy, especially these two surgeries, then we might have to remove some part of the posterior wall, because as I told you, posterior wall connects the middle ear with the mastoid, And sometimes you have to remove that boundary between the mastoid and the middle ear for the proper drainage. We all know all the secretion from the ear drains to the stachian tube, and the stachian tube is permanently blocked due to something. You can't help it. You can't open the tube. So you have to make an alternate drainage from the mastoid. So you have to remove the wall between the middle ear and the mastoid, or middle external ear and the mastoid, so the mastoid will drain directly to the external ear and out. We will not need the stachian tube. This is very often done in mastoidectomy surgeries, different types of mastoidectomy surgeries. So when you are trying to remove the posterior wall, then you might end up traumatizing the facial nerve. So if I ask you that during surgeries of the middle ear, which part of the facial nerve is most commonly damaged or traumatized, then it is the either the vertical part or top of the vertical part. What is the top of the vertical part? Where the facial nerve is turning, so, and the turn of the facial nerve is called zenu. So the first turn, this turn in the labyrinth, remember this turn is called the first zenu, and this turn becomes the second zenu. So this is the second zenu of the facial nerve. So why is this important? Because if I ask you which part of the facial nerve is most commonly damaged or traumatized during mastoidectomy surgery or ear surgeries, second zenu is the better answer. If second zenu is not given, you can say the vertical part of the facial nerve. So each of the four parts in the temporal bone, medial part, labyrinthine part, horizontal part, vertical part, has very important clinical significance, and they are very popular MCQ. Now after this, what happens? After this, the facial nerve comes out of the ear through a canal here. There is a canal here through which the facial nerve comes out, and we all know this canal is called stylomastoid foramen. So if I ask you through which foramen facial nerve comes out of the middle ear, stylomastoid. Most of us know this already, right? And this foramen is so named because it lies between the styloid process and the mastoid bone, stylomastoid foramen. Now what happens once the facial nerve is out of this canal? Remember, there is a gland around the ear. There is a gland here below the ear, parotid gland. So if I draw the parotid gland, something like this, let's say this is the parotid, this green. So our facial nerve enters the parotid gland anteriorly between the superior lobe and the deep lobe of the parotid gland, and while in the parotid gland, facial nerve divides into five terminal branches. So five branches like this. What are these five branches called? Pes anserinus. And what do? They supply all the muscles of the face. So we all, every time we draw it like this, there are the five branches, one goes this part, one goes here, one goes here, one goes here, one goes here, and they supply all the muscles of the face. And this is the end of the facial nerve. Because the facial nerve ends by supplying all the muscles of the face, that's why the nerve is called the facial nerve. That's how you get the name, facial nerve. Right. Now this part, this branch which goes to the temporal area is called the temporal branch of the facial nerve. This one which goes here is the zygomatic area, zygomatic branch. This area is the buccal area, cheek, buccal area. This is the mandibular branch, and which goes in towards the neck is the cervical branch. So temporal, zygomatic, buccal, mandibular, and cervical, five branches of the facial nerve, they supply all the muscles of the face, and that is the end of the facial nerve. Right. Now we are talking about the motor part of the facial nerve. Now, while the facial nerve comes like this and divides into five terminal branches, there are three more other motor branches of the facial nerve. One is in the middle ear, just below the second zenu, there is a branch here. And this branch is called nerve to stapedius. Because it supplies the stapedius muscle. I'm sure you know that just below the second zenu, the turn of the facial nerve, there is a small bony projection on the bony posterior wall. And this bony projection is called the pyramid. The shape of this bone is pyramid, so this bone is also called pyramid. And from this pyramid arises a muscle called stapedius muscle. And this nerve supplies this stapedius muscle, that's why it's called the nerve to stapedius. And what is the use of this or importance of this nerve or this muscle? They participate in what is called the stapedial reflex or acoustic reflex. What is acoustic reflex or a stapedial reflex? It's a reflex produced in the middle ear, which is a protective reflex against the loud noise. So whenever there's loud noise, you get exposed to loud noise, and loud noise, we all know, can traumatize and damage the inner ear hair cells. And once the hair cell gets damaged, it is going to lead to what is called sensitive neural hearing loss, which is very difficult to treat, isn't it? That's why middle ear has a protective mechanism. Whenever there's loud noise, a reflex gets initiated. This reflex is called the stapedial reflex or acoustic reflex. And every reflex will have two nerves, at least two nerves, one afferent, one efferent. So this reflex also has an afferent nerve and the efferent nerve. These are two MCQs now. Which is the afferent nerve in the stapedial reflex? The eighth nerve, the vestibular cochlear nerve, which carries the sound towards the brain, to the cortex. And who carries the signal from the brain that this nerve, this sound is very loud, it has to be protected? The signal comes from the seventh nerve. The seventh nerve is the efferent nerve. And this is the nerve that supplies the stapedius muscle. So this branch is called nerve to stapedius. So the point is, if this branch of the facial nerve gets traumatized or damaged, this nerve to stapedius, the patient will not have a proper stapedial reflex. And when there is no stapedial reflex, that condition is called hyperacusis. So this branch trauma can lead to what is called hyperacusis. Okay, then after the facial nerve comes out of the stylomastoid foramen, there are two important motor branches. I'll draw like this, or let me use a different color, red color, since I've been using red color. There are two branches like this, let's say. One is called posterior auricular branch. Posterior auricular branch, because it supplies the posterior auricular muscles. It supplies the posterior auricular muscle behind the pinna, and also supplies this part of the skull, the occipital, this area. So this is a very insignificant branch, so supplies muscles in this area. So because it supplies muscles, this is also auricular motor branch. And the second one, this one again divides into two, because it will supply two muscles. One is stylohyoid, and posterior belly of the digastric. And we all know facial nerve supplies the facial muscles. Now, these are the motor supply of the facial nerve. Nerve to stapedius supplies the stapedius muscle, posterior auricular supplies muscles of the behind the pinna and the occipitalis area. Then the third branch actually supplies the two muscles. It supplies the stylohyoid and the posterior belly of the digastric. And at the end, the pes ensarinus supplies all the muscles of the face. So this is the motor part of the facial nerve. But we all know, so I'm reviewing all these names. But we all know that facial nerve is not purely motor, it is a mixed nerve, so it has a sensory component also. Let me remove this name also, and I'll remove all these names so that we declutter this and we can use this to write other important things. So we have completed this motor part, which are called special visceral efferent fibers, right? We know this. Now facial nerve has a sensory branch also, sensory fibers also, which I'm going to draw with purple ink. Now the sensory fibers of the facial nerve comes from this, from three areas. I'll just draw it like this, three areas, three nucleus like this. One of them is parasympathetic fiber, which is also called secretomotor fiber. And these are general visceral efferent fibers. And what do they supply? They supply glands. They supply glands, right? What type of glands it supplies? It has two groups. These fibers will divide into two groups. One will go and supply the lacrimal gland, and glands of nose and sinus. So one group of fiber will go to the lacrimal gland and supply the glands of the nose, sinus and palate also. And the second group of salivary glands will go to salivary nucleus, salivary glands like submandibular and sublingual gland. Now these are the glands supplied by this parasympathetic fiber. We'll discuss about this a little later. The third type of fiber are taste fibers. taste fiber to supply the taste fibers are called special visceral afferent fibers, and they supply the anterior 2/3 of tongue. This is the main supply, we all know. Who supplies the posterior 1/3 of the tongue? Posterior 1/3 of the tongue is supplied by the 9th nerve, and posteriormost part of the tongue and a few area in the larynx are supplied by the 10th nerve. So there are three cranial nerves that carry taste fibers. Facial, which is the most important, supplying the anterior 2/3 of the tongue. Posterior 1/3 of the tongue is the 9th nerve, glossopharyngeal, and a very small part in the tongue, posteriormost part, may be supplied by the 10th nerve. But facial nerve supplies anterior 2/3 of the tongue plus minus palate. So there are some fibers, taste fibers in that palate also, and the facial nerve will supply the palatal taste as well. So taste fibers comes from tractus solitarius, nucleus of tractus solitarius, like this, let's say, they will come and join with this parasympathetic fiber in a way. And the last type of fiber are general sensory fiber. General sensory for touch, pain and temperature. And these can be somatic afferent fiber or general somatic afferent fiber, which supplies the skin. Because it is general sensory, touch, pain, temperature is going to supply what? It is going to supply a very small skin, which part of the body? In the external ear. Posterior part of the external ear and the pinna meatus, this area is supplied by these general sensory fibers. So these are the three types of sensory fibers. We have motor fibers, special visceral afferent, we have parasympathetic fiber, general visceral afferent, we have taste fiber, and we have general sensory fibers. These are the four types of fibers that the facial nerve carries. The first one is motor, and rest of the three, they club together and they are called the sensory types. Although parasympathetic is not strictly a sensory fibers, it's a motor, secretomotor, but in facial nerve, it comes with the sensory group. So let's say, now this is special sensory. So you can see there are four nucleus I have shown. The red one is the motor, and rest three are sensory, parasympathetic, taste, and the general sensory. Now these three will join together and form a common nerve, and they will run into the internal acoustic meatus and join with the main facial nerve, the motor bar, and run along with this. Now this is very important. The sensory part of the facial nerve, is called the sensory root of the facial nerve, joins the motor part, which is the main part, in the internal acoustic meatus. And this sensory root has a name. It's a very important name. I'm writing here. It is called nerve of Risberg. Risberg's nerve, also called nervus intermedius. It has two names. It is either called Risberg's nerve or nervus intermedius. This is the sensory root of the facial nerve. So these three will form this root, and this will then join with the motor and form a complete facial nerve. Now, this sensory root runs along with the facial nerve motor fibers through the internal acoustic meatus, through the labyrinth. At the end of the labyrinth, near the genu, where the facial nerve is going to turn backward, the sensory root has a ganglion here. And this ganglion I am writing here is called the geniculate ganglion. Right? Now, this geniculate ganglion is important for two or three reasons. A, where is the geniculate ganglion located? It is located near the first genu. That's why the name is geniculate. From here, from the genu, it gets the name geniculate ganglion. And this is in the labyrinthine part of the facial nerve. And which part of the facial nerve does it belong to? Does it belong to the sensory part of the facial nerve or the motor part? Geniculate ganglion belongs to the sensory part of the facial nerve. And from here, a branch of the facial nerve arises. A very important branch, which I'm going to draw with green here. A branch. And this branch of the facial nerve I'm going to remove all this so that you can write the name of the branches here, rest of the branches of the fissure. This branch is called greater superficial petrosal nerve or greater petrosal nerve, sometimes greater superficial petrosal nerve, whatever you want to call it. Right, so this is the first branch of the fissure nerve. Greater superficial petrosal nerve is actually the first branch of the fissure nerve, which arises from the geniculate ganglion in the labyrinth. This is the only part of the fissure nerve, a branch of the fissure nerve that arises in the labyrinth. Rest either middle ear or outside the ear. So this is first point. And what type of fiber it carries? It carries the parasympathetic fiber. Remember I just told you the parasympathetic divides into two groups. One goes to the lacrimal gland, nose and sinuses, and one group goes towards the submandibular, sublingual gland. So this is the first group that goes towards the nose and the sinus and the lacrimal gland, the parasympathetic or secretomotor fiber. Now this first branch of the fissure nerve, later on as it proceeds, it runs anteriorly into the foramen lacerum. It goes into the foramen lacerum. I'm sure you know that in foramen lacerum, we also have the internal carotid artery. From internal carotid artery, a branch comes and joins this nerve. It will join this greater superficial petrosal nerve, and this branch of the that comes from the internal carotid artery is the deep petrosal nerve. Right. So we have greater superficial petrosal, which comes from the fascial nerve, the first branch, and deep petrosal nerve that comes from the internal carotid artery. And we all know around the carotid artery there is a sympathetic chain. So these are carrying sympathetic fiber. So now we have a nerve which carries parasympathetic from the greater petrosal nerve and sympathetic from the deep petrosal nerve, and this is all happening in a canal in the anterior wall of the foramen lacerum. So when there is a foramen lacerum, if you look at the anterior wall, there is a canal. So both these nerves enter the canal and join together to form what is called the median nerve. This is how your median nerve gets formed, by the combination of parasympathetic fibers in the greater superficial petrosal and sympathetic fiber in the deep petrosal nerve. And where is this nerve formed? In that canal I told you, on the anterior wall of the foramen lacerum. And this canal is called pterygoid canal. That's why this nerve is also called nerve of pterygoid canal. The other name for median nerve is nerve of pterygoid canal. So median nerve is called nerve of the pterygoid canal because it's formed in the pterygoid canal. And when it comes from the anterior end of this canal, it enters a fossa called pterygopalatine fossa, sometimes called sphenopalatine fossa. So this nerve enters this fossa called pterygopalatine fossa, and in this fossa, where does this fossa lies? It lies just behind the maxilla and just below the orbit. Below and behind the orbit and just behind the maxilla, there is a small fossa called pterygopalatine fossa, and this fossa carries a ganglion called pterygopalatine ganglion. Pterygopalatine fossa containing pterygopalatine ganglion. So if I ask you that which nerve relays into the pterygopalatine ganglion, the median nerve, which mainly carries the fibers from the fascia, the parasympathetic fibers from the fascial nerve. Right. And this is the ganglion of the greater petrosal nerve. So please don't make a mistake. We understand that this greater superficial petrosal nerve arises from the geniculate ganglion. Remember, near the first genu in the labyrinthine part of the fascial nerve, but this geniculate ganglion is not the ganglion of this nerve. The ganglion of this nerve is the pterygopalatine ganglion in the pterygopalatine fossa. From here, the post-ganglionic fiber will arise, and they will supply lacrimal gland and glands of nose and sinuses. Nose, sinus, and palate. So, I always say, see, palate is somewhere here, right? And palate divides the oral cavity from the nasal cavity and sinuses. So, all the glands above palate and above till the skull base, all these glands are supplied by this vidian nerve of the pterygoid canal, whether it is lacrimal gland, nasal gland, sinus gland, nasopharynx also, palate, all these glands, and they, all these secretions are controlled by this nerve. So, it is a very important nerve or branch of the facial nerve, right, the first branch, right. After this arises the nerve to stapedius, the motor fiber near the stapedius muscle, we know this. And the third branch, I will talk about this, the fourth branch actually is chorda tympani. This is the most popular branch of the facial nerve. Everybody knows about chorda tympani. Where does chorda tympani arise? It is from the vertical part of the facial nerve. When the facial nerve is just going to come out of the stylomastoid foramen, it gives rise to a branch called the chorda tympani nerve in the posterior wall of the middle ear. And from this posterior wall, it comes into the middle ear through a canal called posterior canaliculi. It comes out through a canal called posterior canaliculi. Not an important name, right? And now it enters the middle ear. Now, this is very interesting. This chorda tympani nerve arises, remember I told you, just posterior wall, just near the stylomastoid foramen. And in the stylomastoid foramen is the lower part of the posterior wall. So, it arises posterior inferior part of the middle ear, and it then goes up, you know, facial, this chorda tympani goes up and then goes to the anterior wall, opposite of posterior wall. It goes to the anterior wall, upper part, and goes out from the junction of the anterior and the lateral wall, right. So, this is another very important point. It is almost running diagonally into the middle ear. So, if I draw the middle ear like a box, we always draw, see, this is the, if this is the external pinna, this is the external auditory canal, this is your tympanic membrane, middle ear is almost like a box. Middle ear is almost like a box, like this. So, if facial nerve, the chorda tympani arises from posterior inferior part, let us say, I have to remove this to give you a sense. If this is a box, middle ear, if the facial nerve, chorda tympani arises from here, where there is a stylomastoid foramen, it goes out like this from the anterior wall. So, this is the posterior wall and this is the anterior wall. In fact, at the junction of the anterolateral wall, anterior wall and lateral wall junction, there is a canal, I will tell you about the canal, it goes out. What is the lateral wall of the middle ear? Tympanic membrane. I will tell you the significance of this. So, first let me write few things here for you. So, it goes, it comes into the middle ear through this canal called posterior canaliculi, and it exits the middle ear through a canal called canal of Hoosier. It exits on from a canal called canal of Hoosier. And where is this canal of Hoosier? It is on the antero, it is at the junction of the anterior wall and the lateral wall. And after it goes out of this canal, this chorda tympani ends soon after it goes out of this canal of Hoosier at the junction of the anterior and the lateral wall. The chorda tympani is only this much. It arises, so let us say from here in this diagram where it arises, it comes out of the canal of Hoosier and it ends here. So, what happened to the fibers of this chorda tympani? The fiber then transmit onto the lingual nerve. So, lingual nerve, which is a branch of the mandibular division of trigeminal, will carry the fiber from here on towards the tongue. Lingual nerve, from the name we know, it is a nerve that is going to supply the tongue, is going towards the tongue, and chorda tympani also carries the taste fiber for the tongue. So, this lingual nerve will carry these fibers to the tongue and supply the taste fiber on the anterior 2/3 of the tongue. But in fact, this chorda tympani carries two categories of fiber. It carries rest of the parasympathetic. Remember, parasympathetic has two groups. One goes to through the greater superficial petrosal nerve, supplying the lacrimal gland, glands of nose, sinus and palate above the palate. This is the second group that is going to supply the submandibular gland, and sublingual gland for this salivary production, saliva production. So it's very important. Almost 75% of the saliva are produced by these two glands. 75% of the total saliva are produced by these two glands. So 3/4 of the saliva production is controlled by the chorda tympani branch of the facial nerve. First, chorda tympani also has taste fiber, like I told you, and they supply the anterior 2/3 of tongue. So this is what your chorda tympani supplies, right? Parasympathetic goes to the submandibular sublingual gland, and taste fiber goes to the anterior 2/3 of the tongue, and they all ultimately reach to the lingual branch of the mandibular division of trigeminal lingual. Right. Now, coming to this diagram, I told you that facial nerve, chorda tympani branch of the facial nerve arises from the stylomastoid foramen, which is posterior inferior part of the ear, and it goes up and goes out from the anterior wall, almost diagonally opposite. So one is posterior wall, opposite is anterior wall, lower down to upper area. So it's going diagonally through the middle ear and then goes out through the canal called Hozier canal, and then it joins the lingual nerve, like I told you. And it goes out through canal called Hozier canal. And where is the Hozier canal? I told you it is at the border of the anterior wall and the lateral wall. What is the lateral wall of the middle ear formed by? The lateral wall, the outer wall, is from the tympanic membrane, right? So it is going just deep to the tympanum. It is actually within the fibers of the tympanic membrane this nerve runs. Now, there are two significance important significance of this anatomy. One, when we do the surgery of the middle ear, how do you enter the middle ear? The easiest way to enter the middle ear is to go through the canal and reflect the tympanic membrane. You remove the tympanic membrane. The moment you remove the tympanic membrane, in front of you is the middle ear. So whenever you remove the tympanic membrane, the first thing that you notice is a nerve running, because this nerve is, I told you, through the tympanic membrane goes. You can see a nerve running, and it is diagonally running through the middle ear, a cord through the tympanum. Middle ear is called tympanum. A cord-like thing is running through the tympanum, that's and through from diagonally opposite. That's why the nerve is called cord in the tympanum, corda tympani. That's how you get its name, corda tympani nerve. So it runs through the tympanic membrane in the middle ear. And that's why during middle ear surgery, the moment you remove the tympanic membrane, you encounter this nerve. That's why this nerve is quite commonly damaged during ear surgeries. Middle ear surgeries, trauma to the chorda tympani nerve is pretty common. It's not very, very common though, but it can happen because it is just at the entry point of the middle ear, you can see. Right. This is one point. The second point, you can see that it goes to the upper part of the middle ear. I'm sure you know middle ear is divided into three compartments: epitympanum, mesotympanum, hypotympanum. Upper one third is epitympanum, middle one is mesotympanum, lower one is hypotympanum. So it goes to the epitympanum also, and it goes through the first and the second ossicles, malleus and incus. So this is how it passes. It arises from the posterior inferior part, then it has to go anterolaterally, and when it's going anterolaterally, it passes between the first and the second ossicles and through the tympanic membrane, and then it goes out of this canal called the Hozier canal to ultimately transfer the fibers to the lingual nerve, from where it will go to the tongue and the submandibular and the sublingual gland. Now, why I told you, because there are two potential questions here. A, facial nerve passes through which ossicles? Facial nerve passes through the first two ossicles, malleus and incus. And second question, which is very commonly asked, that what are the content of the epitympanum, upper one third of the middle ear? There are four things. One of them is chorda tympani nerve. So one is the head of malleus. Head of malleus is there. There is a body of incus, chorda tympani nerve, and the ligaments between the malleus and the incus. Because the malleus and incus forms a joint there, and the joint will have a ligament, there are some ligaments. So if they ask what are the content of the epitympanum, etic, then there are four things: head of malleus, body of incus, chorda tympani, and the ligaments between the two joints. Okay. So after this, what happens? So these are the three. Now, we are left with one more branch. Now, there is another sensitive. Remember, the facial nerve also carries sensory fibers for the canal skin. So we can call it a sensory or auricular branch. Auricular branch of facial, and this is going to supply the skin in the external ear, a small skin in the external ear, right? So this is what you have to know. Now, this branch is slightly controversial. It's not given in many books. Because you know why? This branch, the sensory branch of the facial nerve, you can't see arising from the facial nerve. What happens is, have you heard about Arnold's nerve? Arnold's Elderman nerve? Arnold's Elderman's nerve is a branch of the 10th nerve. And this also supplies the skin in the canal. Now, this Arnold nerve comes into the middle ear through the floor of the ear. It comes in towards the facial nerve, and this carries the fiber or the facial nerve. So, these sensory fibers, they go through the Arnold nerve, and both of them together go to the posterior canal to supply the skin of the canal. So, you will not be able to see a separate branch of the facial nerve carrying the sensory fibers. These fibers go through the Arnold's, which is a branch of the 10th nerve. That's why in some books they don't mention this branch, but we certainly have fibers from the facial nerve which are general sensory in nature, and they supply a very small part of the skin of this canal. Right. So, how many types of fiber do we have in the facial nerve? We have four types of fiber: motor, parasympathetic for the glands, taste for the tongue, and the general sensory for the small skin, which is, like I said, controversial. So, how many branches do we have in the facial nerve? The first branch is the greater petrosal nerve here. Then the second branch is the nerve to stapedius, supplying the stapedius muscle I discussed for the acoustic reflex and all that. The third branch is actually the sensory branch. This is the third branch, the sensory, which is controversial. It goes to the Arnold to supply the skin in the canal. Fourth is chorda tympani, that supplies the taste on the tongue and the submandibular sublingual gland. After this, the facial nerve is out of the ear through the stylomastoid foramen, and then gives a posterior auricular branch for the muscles. Then there is another branch for the stylohyoid and the posterior belly of the digastric. And then the nerve goes into the parotid gland between the superficial lobe and the deep lobe, where it divides into five terminal branches called pes anserinus, and they will supply all the muscles of the face. That's why it's called the facial nerve. So, this is the brief anatomy of the facial nerve. Now, another important point I'll tell you about facial nerve is, as you can see, in the temporal bone, in the ear, when the facial nerve is running, most of the part or the entire part is through the canal, fallopian canal, isn't it? Either through the internal acoustic meatus or the fallopian canal. That's why when you look into the middle ear, you can't see this nerve. It is covered by a canal, a protective canal, facial canal. And if you are doing a surgery in the ear, you have to be very careful that you don't damage the facial nerve. You can't see the nerve and you're doing the surgery, so chances of damage are very high. That's why in the ear, we have some landmarks for facial nerve. Now, these are structures which will give you a signal that facial nerve is close by. You have to be careful. So, which are these landmarks for the facial, anatomical landmark they are called? One very important landmark is called cog, sometimes called jog. Now, cog or jog is a very small bony projection on the anterior wall of the middle ear. The second is oval window. Remember, facial nerve is just above the oval window. Pyramid, remember pyramid? Then there is a bulge of the lateral semicircular canal. Bulge of the lateral semicircular canal is a very important landmark, and digastric ridge. These are the landmarks for the facial nerve that you can remember. So, with this brief anatomy, I'm going to tell you a few things about facial palsy. Obviously, damage to any part of the facial nerve can cause facial palsy. What is the most common cause of facial palsy? Idiopathic, which is also called Bell's palsy. Everybody knows this. Idiopathic facial nerve palsy, which is also called the Bell's palsy, is the most common cause of facial palsy. Then we have infections. Mainly the infections of the middle ear, like ASOM, CSOM, tubercular otitis media, and malignant otitis media, otitis externa. These are the important infective causes of the facial nerve. Then we have tumors. The important tumors are CP angle tumors. So the CP angle tumors, acoustic neuroma is the most important part, and parotid gland tumor. Trauma. Trauma can be either surgical trauma or non-surgical trauma. Remember which is the most common surgery that can cause facial palsy, mastoid surgery, and syndromes. Syndromes like there is a syndrome called Millard-Gubler syndrome. Millard-Gubler syndrome affects the CP angle area where the facial nerve is turning around the nucleus of the sixth nerve. So in this fifth and sixth, seventh and sixth nerve both are damaged. Then everybody knows about Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. In Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, there is a viral infection of the facial nerve, geniculate ganglion. Then we have a very important syndrome called Millerken-Rosenthal syndrome. So these are some of the syndrome, Millerken-Rosenthal syndrome. So these are and systemic conditions like diabetes mellitus, sarcoidosis. So a very long list of causes of facial palsy that you know, and we might discuss about these conditions in a little while. We'll take a break here and we might discuss the further about this.